Let's do this last two weird cases of standard form. Let's remember that standard form looks like this. Ax plus by is equal to c, and a and b cannot both be 0. So the second weird case is when a is equal to 0, and since a and b cannot both be equal to 0, that implies that b is not 0, and we're stuck with an equation that looks like this. Now I can divide by b since it's not equal to 0, and I get that y is equal to c divided by b. And let's just call this a new name, some new name c, where c is a constant. So the question then is, what does the line y equal to c look like? Well, let's check it out over on the coordinate plane. So here we are in the coordinate plane once again. Let's plot, say, y is equal to 3. I don't know. So let's draw a couple of points where y is equal to 3. So here's 3. Here's, say, negative 5, comma 3. Here's another point, which is 5, comma 3, and we really only need 2 points to define a line, so let's just stick with these two. When I connect the dots here, I get this line here. Let's extend it off to the right, and extend this off to the left, and draw some arrows to indicate that it keeps going both ways. Okay, this is just a horizontal line, and it hits the y-axis at 3. Y is forced to be 3, so it has all the points where y is 3. X can be whatever it wants because the equation doesn't say anything about x. So the conclusion we get, the answer we get, is the horizontal line hitting the y-axis at c. Let me just look at one particular case of this, which is we already know that the x-axis is when y is always equal to 0, so the x-axis actually has equation y is equal to 0. Interesting. Okay. Let's look at the last weird case, which is when b is equal to 0. And this means that a cannot be 0 again because not both a and b can be 0. Okay. So, similarly, this reduces to the case that x is equal to d, where d is some constant. So the question now is, what does the line x equal to d look like? Okay. Let's go back to our coordinate plane. Let's plot a couple of points. Let's plot x is equal to negative 6. So here's one point where x is equal to negative 6. That's negative 6, comma 5. And here's another one down here. This is negative 6, comma 2. And again, two points determine a line. So connecting these two guys by a straight line, we get this. Extending it down and extending it up, we get this line right here. It is a vertical line that hits the x-axis at negative 6. Okay, our general answer is that this looks like the vertical line hitting the x-axis at d. And again, we have a special case of this when we look at a particular, sorry about moving that around, the y-axis is a vertical line. It hits the x-axis at 0, so it has the equation x is equal to 0. So that is the upshot. These two weird cases give us the vertical lines and the horizontal lines. Alright. So now let's go to another concept that is fundamentally important to lines, and I'm just going to treat this abstractly at first. Let's suppose I have a line which goes through this point right here, and say this point right here, whatever, and I'm going to connect these two dots from here up to here, great, and then this keeps going kind of that direction, and kind of in that direction, great, there we just have some line going through these two dots. I don't care exactly what they are. Now we would like to talk about the slope of these lines, or of this line and lines in general. And the slope, what is that going to be? It's going to be a sort of a rate of change, or it's going to be in some sense the steepness of the line. And generally we're going to denote it by the letter N. By the letter N. Now it's a rate of change, and really it's the rate of change, so it's really going to be for us the change in Y with respect to the change in X. Well, how can I really formulate that? Well, how does X change when we go from this point to this point? We start here, and we end up over here. That is how X changes. It changes from this point up to this value, from there to there. And we typically like to call this the run, because it is a sort of a horizontal movement. X is moving from left to right. How does Y change? The Y value starts down here and goes up here, so this is the change in Y right here. And we like to call it the rise, because Y, at least in this case, is increasing. Then our formula for the slope is given by the rise divided by the run. And that was supposed to be blue, but it's purple. Too bad. Okay. So it's the change in Y divided by the change in X. That's what I mean by the change in Y with respect to the change in X. Okay. But we can get an explicit formula for this. Let's suppose that this point right here had coordinates. Let me get rid of the blue. I want to go back to black. X1, Y1. And let's call these coordinates here X2, Y2. They're supposed to be constants. Now, the distance I've traveled from left to right here is actually the difference between these two x-coordinates. So the run is equal to x2 minus x1. The rise is going to be the difference between these y-coordinates. I started at y1, I went up to y2, so this is going to be y2 minus y1. That's the distance between those values. So we get a formula then for the slope, which is x2 minus x1. It's the change in Y, which is Y2 minus Y1 divided by X2 minus X1. Okay, so let's just take this idea and this formula right here and frame it and put it on your refrigerator. The slope is the rise over the run, which is the same thing as the difference of the y-coordinates over the difference of the x-coordinates. Let me also note that you could take y1 minus y2, but you would then have to divide by x1 minus x2. You have to make sure that you divide if you subtract things in the same order. Okay. So let's do some specific examples of this. Let's find the slope of the following line. Let's say we start at this point down here, which is going to be -5, -5, and let's suppose that we go up here to 5, 10. In fact, let me change that a little bit. Let me suppose that we just go up to 0, 10. And the line we're looking at goes from here to here. And let's extend it up to the right. Just kind of like that. Extending it down to the left. Does not look like that. It looks more along the lines of maybe that. Okay. So this is our line. The formula for slope says that if we take y2, which is 10, and subtract y1, which is negative 5, and we divide that by x2, which is 0, and subtract that by negative 5, what we end up with is 10. 10 minus negative 5 minus a negative gives you a plus. So 10 plus 5 divided by 0 minus negative 5 gives me 0 plus 5 for the same reason. And I get 15 divided by 5, which is just 3. That is the slope of this line. A good way of interpreting the slope is that this says for each increase in x by 1, y goes up by the slope, 3. So let's see this literally in action. Here, x goes up by 1, y goes up by 3. X goes up by 1, y goes up by 3. X goes up 1, y goes up 3. X goes up 1, y goes up 3. X goes up 1, y goes up 3. Okay. So that's one way of interpreting the slope. This is also a way of finding more points on the line. From negative 5, negative 5, if I add 1 to x, I got negative 4, and if I add 3 to negative 5, I get negative 2. That is what this point is. If I add 1 to x, I get negative 3. If I add 3 to negative 2, I get 1. So that's what this point is, etc., etc., etc. So these are going to be more points on the line. Let's look at one more example of this sort of thing. Let's look at, say, let's start with this point right here. Let's find the slope. Let's say we start with the point here, which is going to be negative 10, comma 5. And let's go down to this point down here, which is going to be 5, comma negative 5. Now, what does this line look like? It goes from here down to here, and extending it upwards, it goes kind of like that, and extending it downwards, it goes kind of like that. Great. What is the slope going to be in this case? Well, let's do y1 minus y2 this time, just to see that it doesn't really matter. So y1 minus y2 is 5 minus negative 5. x1 is negative 10 minus x2 is negative 5. And this gives us 5 plus 5 over negative 10 minus 5. I owe you $10. You lend me 5 more, so I now owe you $15. This is 10 over negative 15. There's a common factor of 5. So 5 goes into 10 2 times, and 5 goes into 15 3 times, so I get negative 2/3. Okay, this time I have a fraction, so if I want to interpret this slope as saying for each increase in x, y changes by this value, that's a little bit hard to plot things out. So actually, maybe a better way of interpreting this is instead literally thinking of this as rise over run. So we'll literally think of 3 as the run, and then we're going to have to think of negative 2 as the rise, and we'll see what that means in a second. But we're really going to say then that if x goes up by the denominator, or by the run, which is 3, y goes, since I've got a negative here, y is going to go down by 2. So what this looks like then is I start here, x goes up by 3 in a second, x goes up by 3, y goes down by 2. X goes up by 3, y goes down by 2. X goes up by 3, y goes down by 2, etc. Okay, that's the end of this section.